Hi, welcome to Chemistry 1001. We're talking about states of matter, and this particular topic is examining how the ideal gas model differs from the real gas. So how do they differ? Well, the principal points at which they differ is at high pressure and low temperature. At low temperature, because as the temperature becomes lower, a gas actually condenses into a liquid, whereas an ideal gas remains a gas no matter what the temperature. So ideal gas behavior, a real gas will deviate from an ideal gas at low temperature. And likewise at high pressure, when you force the molecules to become closer together by applying pressure to them, the intermolecular forces between the molecules become stronger, and this then leads to, again, a higher chance of condensation. Okay, so we've touched on the two reasons there why, which give rise to real gas behavior. One is the intermolecular forces between the molecules. These are non-negligible, whereas the ideal gas assumes that the molecules in the gas just ignore each other, bounce each off each other and the walls, when in actual fact they are weakly attracted to each other and increasingly strongly attracted to each other at low temperature. And the other effect is the volume occupied by the gas. If we increase the pressure so much that the volume of the gas is comparable to the volume occupied by an equal amount of the liquid form of that material, then we might get condensation. So the volume of the gas is an important aspect that we need to take into account when examining a real gas. In the ideal gas, the molecules are assumed to have no volume whatsoever, and you can compress them infinitely. Another thing that might affect ideal gas behavior versus real gas behavior is chemical reactions. For example, when pressure is increased, the system might respond by trying to decrease the number of molecules in the system. And so this increases the chance of the molecules actually reacting. A particular example is NO2. When subjected to pressure, two of those might react to form N2O4, which is a brown-colored gas. So chemical reactions are another reason why real gases would differ from ideal gases. Let's look at some typical gases. And here we are looking at a ratio of PV divided by RT plotted against pressure, in this case from 0 to 1200 bars, quite a lot of pressure in there. This ratio, PV on RT, is sometimes called the Z ratio. For one mole of gas, it should equal one. And this is what's plotted over here, the ideal gas model, where the ratio is equal to one. And we have here a selection of three molecules. And we can see that for the actual gases, the actual ratios, they're not equal to one. They sort of hover around one from between 0 and 400 bar. But then after about 400 bar, they increasingly start deviating from this one value. For example, methane and nitrogen at 1,000 bar pressure, the ratio is equal to 2. So we would have, for one mole of gas, PV equals 2 RT. That's 100% error, 100% error, if you use the ideal gas model at 1,000 bar pressure. By the same token, at lower pressures, we can see that some of the molecules actually have a smaller Z ratio. This can be explained by the fact that the number PV on the numerator is actually smaller than you might expect, presumably because of the attraction of the molecules for each other, actually reduces the volume of the gas somewhat below what might be expected from the ideal gas. So this is an indication of intermolecular interactions. At 400 bar pressure, we see that PV equals RT exactly. So there is a particular temperature by accident at which PV equals RT for a real gas. How do we take these deviations into account? There are many equations of state describing the behavior of a real gas, but the simplest one of these is the van der Waals equation. The van der Waals equation is a simple modification of the PV equals nRT equation to account for the volume of the gas and intermolecular forces. Here is the equation here. On the right-hand side, we have nRT, as always, but there's a different term for V here. The volume in the van der Waals equation is replaced by V minus B, some constant times the number of moles. And this constant B represents the actual volume of the molecule. What that's saying is that the volume occupied by the gas is not V. It's not the volume of the container. It's actually the volume of the container minus a certain constant, presumably the volume of the molecule, times the number of moles of the molecule. So that's the correction for the volume here. Likewise, there's a correction for the observed for the pressure appearing in PV equals nRT. We have the observed pressure here, plus a correction for intermolecular forces, a constant A times N on V, which is essentially the mole density, N on V squared. So as the density of the gas increases, we get a correction to the observed pressure. In fact, the pressure increases in this correction. The actual pressure is higher than the observed pressure as the density of the gas increases, depending on this constant. Shall we have a look at what these constants are, A and B, for different gases? Here's a table, and we have a series of gases here. Here are the A values with their units here, quite strange units, and the B values. The B values are more easily to understand, so let's take a look at those. Helium is a small monatomic gas. We expect that it has the smallest molar volume and it should have the smallest B value, and checking this table, it does indeed have the smallest B value. Let's look at the biggest molecule, CO2. Yes, that's probably the biggest. It's got three atoms anyway. Yes, that has a very big value at 0.0427 liters per mole. But we can see that chlorine has an even bigger B value. It's Cl2, so that is a big atom. It's two of those big atoms together, and it's certainly comparable in value to the CO2 value. Let's look at the A values. Helium has a very small A value relative to all the other molecules. That's because helium is a noble gas. It doesn't have any dipole or intermolecular forces between the helium atoms in the gas, except dispersion. Those are induced dipole forces. Let's go to a gas which presumably has quite a lot of intermolecular forces, like water. In the liquid state, that can form hydrogen bonds, but in the gaseous state, water has a dipole moment, so it has dipole-dipole forces. And you can see that its A value is relatively large. Not as large as Cl2. That doesn't have a dipole. It's a diatomic, homonuclear diatomic molecule, so it doesn't have a dipole. There's no dipole forces there. However, there are many electrons in that molecule, so the dispersion forces are quite important. And that's how you understand real molecules in relation to the ideal gas.